Good morning, Bent Tree. I'm so excited this morning to introduce to you Ryan Loxmo. Ryan and his wife Ashley both grew up here at Bent Tree, and he is now the lead pastor of Real Hope Community Church in the Houston area. Ryan received his master's at Gordon Conwell Theological Seminary in Boston, and then he got his doctorate in biblical studies at the University of Denver. Ryan was the only evangelical believer in his entire New Testament department. It's quite a story. Ryan's written books and articles and curriculum to lead and edify the church. Before Real Hope, Ryan oversaw the small group ministry at a multi-site church. Ryan loves music, he's a history buff, he follows current events really closely. He, for some reason, roots for the Boston Red Sox. But more than anything, Ryan enjoys spending time with his wife, Ashley, and their two beautiful children, Luke and Nora. Ryan's a gifted teacher, and I know that you're gonna be blessed as he opens God's word for us today. And I just wanna give you a little glimpse into what God is doing at Real Hope before he starts.
Good morning. It is an honor to be with you here today. It is always a homecoming for me to come home to Bent Tree. I always think of this as my spiritual hometown. My family started coming to Bent Tree back in 1992, and I wanted to illustrate for you how long ago that was by showing you a picture of what I looked like in 1992 when we started attending here. Look at that. That is the greatest shirt I've ever owned. It's like a rayon Jackson Pollock painting. And my mom with the comb over. I mean, the whole thing just worked. So in 1992, Amy Grant was at the top of the charts with her powerful worship song, Baby, Baby. And the stage at the time at Bent Tree was just covered in potted plants. I mean, just so many plants, ferns, as far as the eye could see. Seriously, I grew up here at Bent Tree. I first encountered Christ in a real way here. This is where I made my faith my own. This is where I met my wife, Ashley, in the youth ministry. This is where I got my first ministry job when I was going to college at UTD. This is where God led me to consider going to seminary. I mean, so many of my most formative experiences happened here at Bent Tree. And 1 year ago, we were rapidly approaching the launch of our church, Real Hope, and I came here to Bent Tree to share the vision of what we wanted to do and to ask for help and prayer and all that sort of thing. And I met with Pete and the other leadership team, and they were just so kind and encouraging and came alongside of us in prayer. And 1 year ago, in August of last year, you, Bent Tree, gave us an extraordinarily generous a financial gift a few weeks before we launched, and that just meant the world to me personally, and it was an absolute game changer for us as a church. And God in his sovereignty knew that 3 weeks later, after getting that gift, after our second Sunday service, when we were driving our trailer back to the storage place after our service, it almost broke apart on the highway with all of our gear in it. And so we were scrambling in the third week of our church to figure out how are we gonna store our gear, how are we gonna transport it, and because of your gift, we were able to go buy some trailers and a reliable truck and that sort of thing, and God's used those for some incredible ministry throughout this year. And so I just wanted to start this morning by just saying thank you personally from me and on behalf of Real Hope. That was just an extraordinarily generous thing that you did for us, and we'll never forget it. And now we're coming up on the 1 year anniversary of our church, and being a part of the Bent Tree Network has been so life-giving for us this year. And in this series, you're gonna get to hear in the coming weeks from other pastors in the Bent Tree Network. They're great friends and gifted communicators. I know you're gonna be blessed by what they have to say. And one more thing on the network. This summer, I had the opportunity to travel to South Asia with a team from Bent Tree here and see firsthand the ministry that you all have done there. And it was so inspiring. And I came home and I was praying that God would allow our church, Real Hope, to partner with with you in some way for what God is doing there, with in a place with just such physical and spiritual need. And so I shared with our church what God is doing there and asked them to give generously, and they just blew me away with what they gave. And so I wanted to tell you, our church is now in a position that we are going to be sponsoring and fully funding two new church planters in South Asia, along with what you guys are already doing here. So, yeah. That was thrilling for us to be able to do that. And so all that to say, it is such a joy to continue to still be a part of the extended Bent Tree family. And if you ever find yourself in Houston on a Sunday morning, we would love to see you. Come by, say hi. I know there's a lot of people at Real Hope who would love to get to know you. Today we begin this series, When God Broke Through. When Pete asked us to think about this series a number of months ago, I began to reflect on what it meant. And, you know, we were being asked to think about a time in our life when God broke through, when we experienced his grace in a new way or his love in a fresh way. And as I thought about that for my own life, I realized, and I think this is true of all of us, is that our spiritual lives are a series of breakthroughs. It's a lifetime of breakthroughs. And I think the series is aptly named When God Broke Through, because you know, the breakthroughs in our spiritual lives, this has certainly been true of me, they're not about, you know, my effort or intelligence or just figuring things out. It's about Almighty God who loves me, leading me somewhere I need to go. And he's the one doing the breaking through. And he's the one who grows us. He's the one who does the heavy lifting in our spiritual growth. And so I want to share with you today a breakthrough that I experienced in my life. It happened about 4 years ago. I had been studying theology for years. I was now in full-time pastoral ministry, and something had happened over those years. Something had happened in my life. I didn't realize it was happening at the time. It was internal. It was quiet. It was incremental. And it was corrosive, looking back. It was really difficult. I found myself viewing God as aloof, as uninvolved, disappointed in me on some level. And I found myself in a place where I was trying to win his approval, or trying to impress him, or trying to, in some way, make myself worthy of the love that I believed that he had for me. And so I had come to a place where, to some extent, I had lost sight of God's love for me and his grace. And I grew up here. I grew up here. I grew up in a church that was all about God's grace and his love. I had amazing mentors. I had great professors in seminary. I knew all that, and this still happened. But then God broke through. In his grace, he jarred me out of where I was. I didn't realize this was happening. Have you ever had the experience when you're in a room and maybe there's a loud air conditioner on, or a fan, or a refrigerator is running or something like that, and you don't even know it, and then it shuts off abruptly and you're like, whoa, that's nice. I didn't know that noise had been going on the whole time, and you feel this sense of relief. It was like that when God broke through to me. It was that sense of relief, and he used a very familiar parable to do it, the parable of the prodigal son. And I went through a season in my life where I couldn't avoid that parable. It was like every book I was reading was about that. Every sermon I listened to happened to be about that. It was articles, it was blogs, it was everywhere. The prodigal son. I felt like God just had this neon sign pointing to that parable. You know, Ryan, listen up. I've got something for you here. And today I want to share with you what God showed me in that season. Because I'm betting some of you right now are in the same place that I was, and you might not know it either. So let's look at the parable together. This might be the first time you've ever heard this parable. This might be the 5,000th time you've heard this parable. But let's all ask God to give us fresh ears and to hear it as if we're hearing it for the first time, and to let the deeper significance of it really sink down into our hearts. So let me pray for us, and then we'll get into it. Lord Jesus, I pray that you would speak to us now. Holy Spirit, you know where each one of us is coming in this morning. You know the barriers in our heart. You know the obstacles in our minds that would prevent us from hearing what you want us to hear. And so we give this time to you, Lord. We worship you in the way that we hear your word. So I pray that you would open our hearts to what you have for us. God, I pray you'd speak through me. Get me out of the way. It's nothing I have to say, Lord. This is your word. And so, Holy Spirit, speak through me, speak to all of us. Let us all leave changed. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. If you have your Bibles, we're going to be in Luke 15, Luke chapter 15. And we're going to start at the very beginning of that chapter, first couple of verses. Starts out this way. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." So we're going to stop there. We see here, Luke gives us in the first two verses of chapter 15, the audience that Jesus is speaking to. And so much of understanding the significance of what Jesus said is understanding who he was saying it to, because he always tailored his message to his audience. And here we have two opposite groups. We have the visibly sinful and the religiously impressive. And they're both listening to him. The Pharisees and tax collectors, And the Pharisees were always just kind of annoyed that Jesus was so comfortable with these people who were so visibly sinful. And so they're muttering about it. They're just kind of grumbling. And Jesus knows this is going on. And so he responds to their muttering by telling three parables in a row. And they're all about something being lost and then rejoicing when it's found. And so they're all three about lostness. In fact, some scholars have called Luke 15 the lost chapter, because that's what it's all about. You have three parables: the parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin, and then the parable of the lost son, aka the parable of the prodigal son. And the prodigal son is one of the most well-known parables of Jesus. I think in the popular imagination, it's mainly about a wayward child, you know, and a forgiving father. And that's not entirely wrong, but it is not the whole story. And so let's get into it. Let's walk through it. Luke 15, we're skipping ahead to verse 11 now. This is where that parable begins. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them." Let's stop there. We have to always remember that Jesus' teaching occurred at a specific place in time, the first century, and that culture and that social context really helps us to understand the significance of what he was saying. He was teaching in a first century context, a Jewish context, a patriarchal environment, and it was an agricultural world. So a lot of the metaphors and things he used reflect that situation that they were in. And so we find some of the meaning of what's going on by understanding that world he was in. And there's a couple startling things happening here. The son asks for his inheritance while the dad is still alive. Now, I think in our culture, that would probably also be a little bothersome. But in that culture, it was deeply offensive. I mean, you couldn't do anything more offensive than that, to speak of this before he was dead. And, you know, at best, it was kind of like his son saying, "You know, I'm not really interested in you and what you have to offer me. Just give me what I'm owed and I'll be on my way." That's kind of at best. At worst, it's like, "I'd be better off if you were dead." And also, in that world, there was a cultural expectation that sons would show public respect and deference to their father. So he's completely failing on that front, and he's asking for this inheritance now. And, you know, there was no Wells Fargo in the first century. You know, the dad couldn't just go to the ATM or write a check. His wealth would have been in property and livestock. So this was a lot of upheaval that the son was asking for. The dad would have had to sell property and sell livestock and try to get this money together. And so it would have been a very public, shameful thing. And so very shocking that the son asked. More shocking that the dad did it. The dad actually did it and gave him his inheritance, and off he went. Let's keep reading. Verse 13. "Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything." So here's what's going on. We know he was distant relationally from the father because of the request, the fact that he asked for the inheritance. Now he has distanced himself spatially from the Father. He's gone to a faraway country. He's lived this extravagant lifestyle. He's spent through everything. It's all gone. And he takes a job working with pigs. Now that tells you really how far away he went, because Jews did not eat pork. Pigs were an unclean animal. There would have been no pig farmers anywhere near Israel where he was from. So he was very far away. And the fact that he's working with the pigs, wanting to eat their food, just shows how far he has fallen. From a cultural perspective, if you're a Jewish father, to think of your son running away, working with pigs, it's like, you can't imagine him falling farther away than that. And so Jesus is painting this very dramatic picture of just how far away this son was, how much of a break there had been. Let's keep reading. Verse 17, when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. We'll stop there. So here's a picture of repentance, right? He realizes what he did was wrong, and he's turning to go back home. That's the essence of repentance, is turning back toward God. And he begins to rehearse this little speech. Okay, I'm going to go home, and I'm going to say this, and I'm going to say this, and then my dad's going to let me work on the farm. And his heart's in the right place in the sense of, I need to repair this and go home. But there's a key error in his thinking. He believed that his father's love for him was based entirely on his behavior, and that his status as a son was based on what he did and not who he was. And he assumed, because of his bad behavior, he had forfeited once and for all his sonship. That was over. Let's keep reading, verse 20. So he got up and went to his father, but... And here comes, I think, one of the most beautiful phrases in all of Scripture. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe, put it on him, put a ring on his finger, sandals on his feet, bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. The father had been waiting for him. You know, he'd just been looking. You know, one day he's going to come back. And then I just love the picture. You know, he sees him on the horizon. Is that him? And he can't help it. He runs to his son, runs toward him. And, you know, he would have lifted up his robe and run. This is a very embarrassing thing in that culture for a dignified patriarch to do. He doesn't even care. He's just overcome with love for his son. He runs and he embraces him. And then the son tries to launch into his little rehearsed speech. Okay, Dad, here you go. You know, I've sinned. And his dad just cuts him off and says, no. I'm just going to take you back. You know, put a robe on him, ring, sandals. These are all signs of sonship. You're my son. And this incredible scene of grace. You know, the son doesn't deserve this, but the father, his love is just, he can't contain himself. He's so thrilled to have his son home. And so kill the fattened calf. An expensive thing reserved for the greatest of celebrations. His son is home. He was lost and he's found. And this is a beautiful moment. And I think that we often think of this parable, those of us who are familiar with it, as mainly being about this part of the story, right? It's a father who forgives his sinful son, and it's about forgiveness. And again, that's part of the story, but that's just act one. Act two is where the real deeper significance of what Jesus was teaching comes out. And it's in act two that God broke through for me. Remember who he's talking to. The sinners and the Pharisees. Those are the two groups. In Act 1, the father represents God. The younger son represents the sinners, the people who've openly rebelled against God. And now in Act 2, the religious leaders, the Pharisees, are going to come into view in the figure of the older son. So let's keep reading. Verse 25. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him, but he answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you, never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat to celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him? So now you see the older son also shaming the father by publicly disapproving of him and disrespecting him. He's lecturing him. Look, he says, you know, how dare you? You know, and he lists his credentials. I've obeyed you. I've worked hard. Everything you've asked of me, I've done it. And he squanders our wealth and you reward him. That makes sense. Can't you just hear him? That's not fair. This is not fair. He feels robbed. And it reveals something about the heart condition of the older brother is this, that it's the same as the younger brother's heart condition. You see, he viewed his status as a son as about his behavior. You know, I've earned this. Look at everything I've done. And he cared more about the father's stuff than the father, just like the younger brother. The older brother may not have run away and visibly sinned and outwardly rebelled, but he stayed and rebelled inwardly. He obeyed for all the wrong reasons. And then we see the father's response in the last two verses. He says this, my son, the father said, you're always with me. Everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. Imagine you're a Pharisee listening to Jesus tell this story. I think you'd be getting a couple of messages. I think you would probably have a sense of, okay, you know, if you love God, you should be celebrating when the lost are found and not bothered by them first. But the second message you would be getting, and this was the real breakthrough for me. This was like the light bulb when I learned this and read about this and understood this. I'm going to put it up on the screen for you because this is what just changed my outlook, is that our goodness can become a barrier in our relationship with God. Our goodness can become a barrier. Put another way, according to this parable, we can distance ourselves from God in two ways. Running away, outright rebellion, doing our own thing, that's a younger son, or by staying with God and obeying him for all the wrong reasons and being more concerned about what he can do for us. We can alienate ourselves from God in both of those ways. And so I think the parable is probably better titled The Parable of the Lost Sons, because you see a picture of two sons alienating themselves from God in two different ways. Both of them are forms of rebellion. But behind both is the same heart issue, a lack of trust in God's goodness and his love. It's a lack of trust. You know, the younger brother, yeah, he trusts in himself and his own judgment. You know, I want to live my life the way I want to live it. I'm going to rule my world. Just give me my money and I'll be on my way. He didn't trust that his God had his best interest at heart, or his father had his best interest at heart. He's going to figure it out. And maybe that's you. You know, maybe you are just kind of going through life day by day trying to figure it out. I'm just going to figure it out on my own. I'm just going to make the best of whatever comes my way, and I can do this. I don't need God in my life. You know, that's just what my parents believed. I don't need that. And in the process, maybe you found yourself doing destructive things in your life, in your family's life, and you have felt alienated from God. And maybe you feel like he would never want you back. You've gone too far. The message for you from the parable of the prodigal son is that God wants you to come home. He is looking for you on the horizon, hoping that you will come down the driveway back home. That is the way God views you. He loves you. He wants you to come back. Nothing is stopping you from coming home. But maybe you're more of an older son type. And you think in some way that God will accept you or love you if you are a good person and you follow the rules and you're a moral individual. That's called moralism. It's following all the rules for the rule's sake, or trying to get God to give you what you want by obeying him. And so you attend church and you give and you serve and you do everything that God asks because you want him to give you what you want, or, you know, you just want him to be in your corner or something like that. You're trying to get something from him. And ultimately, you're trusting in yourself. When you do that, when you follow God's rules for their sake, you are trusting in yourself. You're trusting in the merit of your moral behavior instead of God. And this is an especially dangerous place to be, because that kind of life doesn't register as rebellion for us. We don't equate it with the visible rebellion of running away or denying God. We just think, no, God made these rules and I'm following them. What's wrong with that? But we're putting all the burden on ourselves and we're trusting in ourselves. By the way, we can take anything in our spiritual life and make it a work, something that we work hard at to get God to love us or get God to give us what we want him to give us. We can take anything and make it that. Did you know you can even take your faith and make it a work? You can make your faith a work. And here's how it sounds when you do that. I've just got to have faith. I've got to have more faith. I'm going to be the best at faith. I'm going to have so much faith. God's going to be so happy with me and impressed that he's going to do this in my life. That is making faith a work. The biblical concept of faith is closer to the idea of trust, what we think of as trust. And so our faith in God is not about our ability to have great faith, the amount of our faith, the quality of our faith. That's actually trusting in our ability to be good at having faith. Faith is about choosing to trust a trustworthy God every day, actually trusting in him and believing that he loves you and he's with you. And so whether your path is open rebellion, like the younger brother, kind of outward rebellion, or moralism, the older brother, inward rebellion, both of them are a form of distancing ourselves from God. Both of them show a lack of trust in God's goodness and his love, and they hinder our relationship with him. The biblical gospel, which is so vividly illustrated in this parable, tells us that God's love for us predates our love for him. He loved us first. His grace transcends our bad behavior or our misguided good behavior. That's what the gospel teaches us. Our good behavior and our bad behavior can alienate us from God, can become barriers if our heart's not in the right place, if we're not actually trusting God. Now, I want to read just a few short verses to you. These are like classic gospel passages, and I'm going to make a couple comments afterward, but I'm just going to read them pretty quickly. I want you to listen to this and let this stuff sink in. Romans 5, it says this, "At just the right time when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Not when we cleaned up our act. While we were sinners, Christ died for us. How about this one? Ephesians 2. "It's by grace you've been saved through faith. This is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." How about this one? 1 John 4. "This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." What do all of these passages have in common? They paint a picture of God's initiating love toward us, that he took the first step, that he loved us first. We cannot earn his approval, earn his love, impress him. He loved us first. And here's the other thing that I learned. The other thing that these three passages have in common is they're all in letters in the New Testament. Romans, Ephesians, 1 John. And you know what that tells us? They were all written to Christians. People who already believed in Jesus. The most profound expressions of the gospel were written to believers, people who believed it. And that tells us we need to keep hearing it over and over. That was a huge breakthrough for me, is I need the gospel. I need the gospel in my life. The gospel is not Christianity 101. It is not part of the message. It is the message. We never outgrow the gospel. We never graduate from it. I mean, Paul said in Romans 1, he writes a letter to the Christians in Rome, and he says, I can't wait to come and preach the gospel to you. These are Christians. And Paul's saying, I need to come preach the gospel to you. And I realized I had, the gospel for me, unconsciously, had become that thing you tell people so that they'll become Christians. And that's wrong. I needed to hear the gospel in new ways, in fresh ways, in an ongoing way in my life. And I had to be reminded that God's love for me is not contingent on my behavior. My value is not in, you know, how good I am at doing these things. My value is in the fact that I was created in God's image, that I was worth dying for. He gave himself for me. I'm something because I'm in Christ. That's why. And when you internalize that, when you really let that settle down in, it changes everything. It changes your view of God. It changes your view of yourself. It changes the reasons why you do everything. Because guess what? You're no longer trying to impress God. By the way, good luck impressing God. But you can just stop that. You can stop trying to impress him, trying to get his attention. And you can understand, I've been loved. I was worth dying for. And he loves me, and he's with me, and I can trust him, and he's good. And instead, I can try to live in the fullness of the freedom that he purchased for me on the cross. I can live out that grace and enjoy him. But the problem is our experience in life can sometimes push us away from that understanding of the gospel. You know, maybe in your case, when you grew up, you had to really impress your parents to get any kind of attention or affection. And so you just carry that over into your spiritual life, and you're just trying to impress God all the time and just get his attention. If I do this, he'll like me. It's not true. Or maybe in your life, everything you've achieved has been the product of just grit and just working hard, and I just made it happen. And so you bring that over into your faith life, and you view your faith in Christ, your identity as a believer is mainly about work. I'm gonna strive, and I'm gonna be a better Christian next year than I was this year. Or maybe you're a really talented person, and you've always excelled at school and sports and all that. And so you carry that over into your faith life, and you're gonna achieve everything about your faith. I am gonna achieve big things for God. But what happens when you're not doing that? Then you wonder, well, does God love me? Is he okay with me? He must be disappointed because I'm failing, obviously. And all these thoughts that enter into your head. Or maybe you grew up in a faith tradition that really was a lot more about the rules and guilt and all that kind of stuff. And so your default setting is that you just think God doesn't like you very much. He's just kind of uninterested. It's not true. You know, 4 years ago, God broke through to me with the parable of the prodigal son. Truthfully, I'm not really sure why I ended up where I did, but I ended up in that place where I just was viewing God in a just warped way. And I thought, you know, he's just kind of not that happy with me. And I found myself trying to impress him. I'm not sure why I was there, but I know this. When he broke through, I was surprised. I mean, I didn't know I was there. It was like I was snapped out of a daydream I didn't know I was having. I was surprised by the relief that I felt. And I could see that God really had become something he's not. In my mind, he was distant. He was maybe disappointed sometimes, unpredictable. I felt like I didn't know who he was, instead of the truth, which is that he's loving, he's trustworthy, he's constant. And God used this parable to teach me that. I don't think it's a coincidence that around this time, 4 years ago, I became a dad for the first time. And so the whole significance of a father loving the son, unconditional love, that whole thing, I just saw it in a different way. And so I felt like God used this to give me a fresh encounter with his love, a fresh understanding of who he is, what grace is about. I feel like he'd given me back the lens of grace that for some reason I'd lost. And he just gave me that new prescription. And he gave it back to me. And it's something he did. He broke through for me. I didn't even know. And when I look back at the last 4 years, I think God did that in part to lead me to the place one day where I would be involved in starting a church and insist on it being a church that's about grace and about Christ and about the gospel and be vigilant against it ever becoming a place that's about earning a standing with God or performing or trying to make yourself worthy of him. And you know, God has purposes for you. He has purposes for each of us. He's wired each of us differently. He's given us different gifts. This is how the church works. And he has purposes for you. And we are his ambassadors, it says in the New Testament. And guess what? When you're the ambassador, you don't make up the message. You're representing the one who does make up the message. And so we have to understand the gospel, who we are in Christ, so that we can then represent him to others well. And God wants to do that through all of us, but we've got to be clear-eyed about the fact that we have a tendency to run from God or to stay and work to impress him, to earn our status. Our thinking about ourselves and about God will naturally devolve into that if we don't ask God to prevent that from happening. Because you know why? The gospel is countercultural and it's counterintuitive. It is not about fairness at all. The gospel is not about you getting what you deserve. It's about the fact that Christ got what you deserve on the cross. It is not about what you deserve. And that just doesn't compute for us sometimes. And so we have to ask the Holy Spirit, as we do in every aspect of our spiritual life, we ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, would you do this in me? I can't do this on my own. Would you allow the truth of the gospel to stay cemented in my heart? Because I'm going to think about it in weird ways sometimes. And I don't want to live there. So I need you to remind me of the truth of who you are and who I am. And so we ask the Holy Spirit to preach the gospel to us over and over and over daily. When we pray, when we read scripture, when we're around other Christians, we pray, Lord, would you let them speak the truth of the gospel into my life? And would you make me available to speak the truth of the gospel into their life? We tell each other the truth and we ask God to remind us that his love for us does not dim because of our mistakes and it doesn't shine more brightly because we're very moral people. He loves us so much so that he gave his life for us. We are loved. We were worth dying for. And we are welcomed in to God's family by faith, by trust, because of God's grace that he showed to us in Christ. And so we've got to ask God to do this in us. So I'm going to pray and I'm going to ask that the Lord would teach us in an ongoing way each day. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your love for us, God, that you are that father who looks out into the distance hoping that we will come home when we stray. And you're that father who patiently speaks truth to us when we follow you for the wrong reasons, or we make our faith mainly about impressing you, or we make our faith mainly about getting what we want from you. But God, you're there with your grace every time, and you're there with your love every time. And Holy Spirit, we acknowledge that we are prone to wander from the truth, to think about you in ways that are not true, to think about ourselves in ways that are not true. And so would you, Lord, preach the gospel to us over and over, every day. Shape our hearts with this. Help our life to be one long, joyful thank you for everything you've done, for the love that you've already given us. Help us to just love you back and enjoy that freedom that you purchased for us. And Lord, we understand that these breakthroughs are from you. It's in your power that these things happen. You are the one who changes us. So would you do that, Lord, in our hearts? Would you change us? Thank you for loving us. Thank you for giving yourself for us. Change us. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.